would I get all of you? If I told you I'm anointed, could you see the proof? Give my heart and soul for you when I'm inside the booth. Feel my love, feel my pain when I'm inside the booth. Would you switch a change on me if you knew the truth? Knowing I ain't the same person that was introduced. Thank the Lord, cause I don't look like what I've been through. Here's a letter to you.
What's going on, man? Big episode today. Not only is this our 20th episode, but also we have a special guest in the building, the man born the day before Christmas.
Yo,
and NFL athlete, my boy Ryan Neal. What's going on, man?
What's good, bro? What's good, man? Glad to be here. Thanks for having me, dog.
Appreciate you showing up,
for
bro.
For sure. Gotta do it for the crib for the one time.
Definitely.
Absolutely.
So we just started off, man. How has Corona been affecting you and your family, bro?
Man, shoot, affecting me. So, I mean, as you know, the whole sports world just got rocked. I mean, hit, like, out of nowhere. Everything, for real. Everybody, jobs, lifestyles, relationships. So, it's just been a crazy time, and especially, you know, with sports. It's like, man, I was supposed to have been in OTAs last month. There's a lot of stuff that's supposed to be going on, you know, baseball players and basketball players, and now it's just kind of, it put a halt on the world, man. It put a halt on everybody, like kind of just making everybody sit down and kind of just think about what's going on. And it kind of makes you realize, like, man, like you would never thought that life can get put on hold like that. And, but as far as like me, man, it's just you continue to find a way to work, man. Ain't no, the work don't stop just because the world stops. So I'm still out here getting it, still doing my workout, still grinding, you know, putting the time in. But you know, it's been kind of hard. I ain't been able to see my family like that because, you know, you can't really travel like that. And That's kind of the biggest effect, for real. But other than that, man, hey, the work don't stop. You know what I'm saying? Definitely. Just because you stop the world, I mean, I'm going to stop. So Just kept it rolling, bro. But other than that, man, just trying to get back into it and just, like I said, take the time to just be thankful. You know what I'm saying? You here. You know what I mean? You're alive, you know, and you just got to take the time to just sit down and just be with yourself once. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Let everything slow down. Get back in your own head and see what's what. So it's been smooth though, man.
Yeah, man. I know I've been, ever since this started, I've been trying to tell people, like, use this as a lesson, man.
Absolutely.
Like, learn something from it.
Heck yeah.
Learn a new skill or whatever the case may be. So.
Heck yeah, man. That's the right thing to do. It's like I said, it made the whole world stop. So now you got time to sit here and, you know what I'm saying, take it all in. Like, man, you can do so much more things. I done picked up a couple things, read a couple books, man. Like, it's like, man, like, you know, just seeing what you're missing out on, you're so stuck in that cycle of life. So it can be a positive if you make it, you know what I mean?
Yep, definitely got to make it a positive.
Yeah.
And we got to touch on just the racial injustice in the world, man. It's crazy. Have you been, like, experienced? I mean, I know, obviously, you've been experiencing it, but, like, what are your thoughts on it? Like, where do you think it should go from here?
It's so many different ways and avenues to come at it, bro. And I'm going to just start off with, like, us as a black community. It's like, first and foremost, let's get our stuff together. You know what I'm saying? Let's actually come together for a common goal. And that's one thing I think that's been missing and is still missing now, because now you got so many people arguing so many different points and there's so many different ideas and ways to go about it. And truthfully, it's like, we don't really have a set leader. Like back then, you know, you had your Malcolm X and your MLK. Now it's like, okay, who? You know what I mean? So now you got a lot of people, you know, it's a chaotic period. You got people fighting over leadership and which way should we go? We should we tear everything up? Should we do this? And it's just been crazy, man. And the thing is, like, we live this lifestyle every day. You know what I'm saying? We have to, it's different when you have to literally tell yourself, okay, let me make sure I'm not riding around looking some kind of way. You know what I'm saying? And that's what I was trying to tell, like, some of my friends, you know, who are white, my teammates. It's just like, you don't, it's a burden that you don't have to think about. And when you growing up, have your parents actually sat down and told you, okay, listen, when you get pulled over, like, not just to, just make sure you follow, no. You know what I'm saying? Roll your windows down, take your hood off, make sure you got your ID in your hand. Yes, sir, no, sir. And it's like, because for us, it's not that we gonna get arrested. You know what I'm saying? It's, you could possibly lose your life. You know what I'm saying? And it's like, when you try to explain that to them, it's like, man, it's a different view. And so what we got to do is, like I said, as a community, as a black community, we got to come together. We got to band together. We actually got to do something now. We can't just be all talk. posting this, posting that, and then a month later we just back to normal. It can't be back to normal.
Mm-hmm.
And it all starts with teaching the youth, you know what I'm saying? Like, I for one was one of the dudes that never took politics serious. It's like, that don't matter. Like, you know what I'm saying? What does my vote matter? And it's like, right. And my coach sat down, he said, listen, if you really want to change something, you got to learn the game. Just like with anything, you got to learn the game to this, man, and then start locally, you know what I'm saying, in your town. Like, who is your sheriff? Who are the people that are in power? Like, if you don't even know that, that's a problem.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, nationwide, our community, we vote the least. We don't vote, like, we don't vote on a presidential scale, and we don't even vote on the local scale. So it's like, if you really want to change, we got to start doing something, man. To the, you know, to, like I said, my white brothers in the white community, this is something that they got to look in their own bloodline and their history, and they got to go, okay, we can't do this no more. Like, this is just wrong. Like, you can't. You got to teach they got to teach their kids, like, listen, you won't have to go through this, but this is something you need to be aware of. You need to understand that. And so it's a two-sided thing that just, it'll only work like that if both sides do it. If one side doing it, the other side not, we still gonna have this tension in the middle no matter what. So
yep.
It's just, we gotta make a change, man. Like I said, to start with just the voting and the teaching of the youth and understanding who we are and our history too. Like, you understand, you God made you blessed. You know what I'm saying? We are black people, we strong. It's in our history, we overcome. So you have to wear that like a S on your chest and ride out, man. So that's just kind of where we got to go from here, man. But it's been crazy, though. It's been wild. It's ugly, dude. It's just,
man,
ugly.
I was saying, and I'm glad that you said that. Yeah. It's both sides of it, because I said, I don't know if y'all saw it on social media, mm-hmm. but I was saying it's not black versus white. Like, it's a fight against racism. Yes. That's what it is, regardless of what color you are.
For sure. It's a fight against racism, and more importantly, it's a fight against police brutality. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times when we talk about the subject, it gets lost. You know what I'm saying? Because now people just saying whatever. Like, no, this is a fight against police brutality and systematic racism, because it's very alive and it's very prevalent, and you can't ignore it. You know what I'm saying? And if you ignore it, you're part of the problem. Like, you can't ignore that. Like, it's there. So it's just, yeah, man, people got to stay to the task at hand, stay focused. Like, you know, you got all these companies making these statements. I don't want no statements from y'all. I want the police force to change. Like, I want them to change. Like, get the systematic racism to change. Don't try to butter me up now because you're trying to save face and keep making your money. That's not what I want. I want that to change. So that's just something that's just got to happen, man, across the board. It's across the board with everybody, bro.
Mm-hmm.
It's across the board.
Within the NFL community, like, obviously we had the Drew Brees situation.
Right.
And I'm not asking you to, like, do no names or nothing like that. But have you experienced, like, a different, I don't want to say a different way people been acting, but you know what I'm saying. Like, have you been experiencing it within?
See, like, right now, so what we did, I'll tell you what we did as the Seahawks. So literally, when George Floyd thing went down, and Pete Carroll, shout out to him, because he is hands down one of the best people I ever met. And he literally took a whole Zoom meeting that we supposed to talk about football. We're not talking about football today. We're going to split up into groups, and we're not recording this. We're going to talk about it. Everybody going to say their piece. Everybody need to talk about it. So we literally split up into groups. White and black and all, everybody one at a time, just talking about what's going on, how they felt about it. And it was such a cool time, because it was a time for us to understand, not only for my white teammates to understand where we coming from, but to understand how they were raised and why it's like, why have they been ignoring it? It's because, like, they don't talk about it. It's like they literally just don't talk about it. Like, you got a group, like, you got one group, you know, racist grandparents, it's taught to them from birth. Like, this, and then you got another group where, well, I grew up in, you know, Utah, where most of us, you know, we're just white, but we don't see that in our community, so we just, you know, we just don't talk about it. And then you got the few that, you know, we see it, but we're not gonna say anything about it because we don't want to make, you know, ourselves look bad to our family. So it's just a bunch, and that's what they were explaining. And it's just like, you know, I'm glad that there's an understanding. Now, where do we go from here? Now you go home and tell your children, this is what we have to do now, because if you playing in the same locker room as me. And I'm saying to you, hey, I'm doing everything on this field for you and I for a common goal. Like I tell people, football is like the greatest example of how the world should be ran. You got a bunch of different people from a bunch of different backgrounds, different sides of the earth and all that. No father, both parents, poor, all that. But we all come together for what? One common goal. And we love each other to the fullest. And that's just how it should be in life. It's like, dude, we need to just be one together. Like, That is the best way I can put it. And so it was just a great time that we did that. And there's an understanding. Like, some of the teammates said, like, I don't want to come in the locker room and there be tension. Like, I don't want that. Like, I love y'all. You know what I'm saying? Like, I understand. Like, just tell me what can we do to move forward. So that's kind of what we did that day. Like I said, shout out to Coach Carroll. Shout out to the Seahawks for doing that. And we did it more than once too. It was really probably the whole week. We even took some meetings off because they had a bunch of stuff going on in Seattle. It was like, man, y'all go out there. Like, get out there. Go, you know what I'm saying? And he literally told us, go do that. He gave us a grant, go do that. And it was just an awesome time, man. So shout out to them for that. It was really cool.
Yeah, for sure, man. Mm-hmm. Definitely. You know, you always hear about bigger companies, organizations, sports, businesses, mm-hmm. whatever, you know, issuing these statements and, oh, he's a great person. But yeah. to hear legit, this is what we're going to do, mm-hmm. like, forget football right now. That shows a lot of character, man. Yeah, for real.
That's why I said shout out to him. It ain't nothing but love from my side. You know what I'm saying? Like, that was cool to see that actually happen and be a part of it. So mm-hmm. that was dope.
That should be what's going on everywhere, really.
Literally everywhere. It should be like that. So,
because if you don't, as coming from the other side, you know, let's mm-hmm. say I was a white male raised in Utah, like you said, mm-hmm. just because I don't understand it doesn't make me a racist.
Right.
You know, it takes hearing it or seeing it, talking exactly. to understand what's yeah. going on.
So that about it, you teaching it, it's like it's a safe space. So like, we're not snapping. I just want you to understand. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Understand what is and what is not. And it was really cool to do that, man. And everybody was just on board with it. And you know, it was just an awesome time, man. I'm glad we did that.
For sure. Shout out Coach Carroll, man.
For sure. Shout out Coach Carroll and the Seahawks, man. That was dope.
So we might as well talk about sports somewhat, though. You know, I don't want to talk about straight sports. I want to include your life into it.
Man,
so
no problem, man. I'm here.
For sure. We all miss sports, man.
For sure.
Tell us about your journey, man, to the league.
Man, where do I start? Sure. Guess I started off in high school, man. So you already know, played ball in high school, was doing my thing. But I didn't get the looks that I thought I should have got. And, I mean, that's just a credit. I mean, the thing is, you know, the state of Indiana, we hooping. You know what I'm mm-hmm. saying? We hoopers up here. You want to find some hoopers, you come to the Midwest. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Down south kind of got that football on lock. That's what they do. So
yep.
I just felt like that was kind of a thing that kind of held me back. And, I mean, the numbers was there. I had the numbers. Like, I had it all. But it just didn't line up. Didn't go to a lot of camps coming out. And, you know, got turned down by some schools that I thought I was going to go to. Like, really sold out for, shed some tears. But, you know, one day I was in the crib just chilling. I'm like, man, I don't know what I'm about. I might not play ball. And then my school, SIU, you know, called me up and was like, hey, man, we want to offer you a scholarship. I ain't never talked to these dudes, but, like, ever. Like, they ain't hit. So I was like, man, what is this? This is like a D2 school. Like, I'm like, all right, man. So I get to Googling. I'm like, all right, okay, D1 FCS. All right, cool. And the Indiana State was ringing my line. So I was like, all right, I'll go take some visits. What, you know, Indiana State, didn't like it, I ain't gonna fake it. I was like, this ain't it. You know what I'm saying? Went to SIU, and I was like, you know, this is actually kind of dope, man. I'm gonna go ahead and commit here. And then, you know, went ahead through that process, true freshman, played my freshman year, sophomore, changed positions, played corner, which was new for me. I was always the dude in the back end, just going to get the ball and tackling people. And then my junior year, went back to safety, and senior year, finished out strong, and you know, didn't make no kind of accolades, like no all conference, like none of that. I didn't make none of that. You know what I'm saying? Didn't get no bowl game invites. So it was just, you know, grind time. And, you know, shout out to my brother for paving the way. You know what I'm saying? I got to mention that because he did pave the way for me. He got at least my name kind of holds something. You know what mm-hmm. I'm saying? So, you know, scouts would come through and talk to me. And this is what it came down to. It was, you know, when I got with my agency, it said, you got to perform at this pro day. And it was Northwestern's because our pro day, the scouts really didn't come. It was just, we didn't have really good records and whatnot. So mm-hmm. ended up going to Northwestern and killed it, shot the numbers. And then next thing I started getting phone calls up and were like, who are you and where have you been? I'm like, I just been here. You know what I'm saying? So it came down to, I pretty much knew I was going to go undrafted, which ain't a problem. You know what I'm saying? As long as I get, like I told them, I just want an opportunity. You get me get an opportunity, that's all I need. You mm-hmm. know what I'm saying? So Atlanta, Philly, who else had called me at that time? Jacksonville was calling me at the time. Tampa called me a couple times. But it came down to the end. When you're undrafted, you get to choose. So mm-hmm. I was like, man, I'm going to go ahead and go to Philly. So I went up going to Philly. First day of rookie minicamp, I get a grade 2 hamstring strain. Mm-hmm. First day I get there. And so I'm like, man, undrafted. You know, they don't really care for these undrafted dudes, mm-hmm. man. It's like, you can't do nothing when you hurt. You know what I'm saying? So I'm like, dude. So kind of going through that message, and that's like, this is my first time in the league. And I'm like, man, you know what I'm saying? Well, they probably gonna let me go. So just going through that whole process, ended up kind of getting back together for training camp. Wasn't really 100%. After that first week of training camp, gave me the boot. So I'm like, dang. So then the crazy thing was the first preseason game was at the end of that week. I got cut before that, so I didn't get to play in the first preseason game. So I go back to Carbondale because I had an apartment out there, and me and my fiance was out there at the time, and I was just, man, I was hurt. You know what I'm saying? I'm just, I ain't get a chance. Like, I was just really hurt because I ain't get a chance. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Like, I ain't get a chance to prove nothing, and I done worked so hard and came this far, and I was just all over. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. I'm undrafted. I don't have no game film. Like, so there's no way another team gonna call me. But Atlanta loved me. They loved me from day one. They wanted me to come there from day one, and I didn't choose them, and I regretted it. But they called me back. They said, we're gonna fire you out for a workout. I said, dope. They said, you do a good workout, we'll think about signing you. I said, cool. On the way to Atlanta, the coach called and was like, hey, if they don't sign you, we're going to bring you here for a workout. So I had something lined up. So I said, all right, okay, I got a shot. You know what I mean? So get to Atlanta, I do the workout. And, you know, they looked at me in the face like, hey, yeah, we're going to bring you in. We're going to bring you in. Just give us some time. Hey, this is the lead. Give us some time. We got to figure out who got to let go. So I was like, oh, man, all right. So I'm literally sitting in the cafeteria eating my food, and I'm watching the dude they letting go. Like, I'm like, so you know what I'm saying? Like, it's cutthroat, you know what I mean? So, but I get there, you know, they got done playing the first preseason game. So now this is, you know, going into the second one. So now I went from one team running a whole different playbook and, you know, another system in another area. And I got to go to another team running a whole other playbook. And they made me play corner at first. So now I got to play another position that I really don't play. I'm like, golly, man, ain't no way. But, you know what I'm saying? Shout out to Coach M, Marquand Manuel, C-Jack, Charlie Jackson, man. Them dudes really, really took the time to educate me on their system, on the playbook, showing me all type of love. Let me know if I'm going to make this team, it's all about 1,000% effort. At the end of the day, you better be the dude hunting everybody down on this football field. Like, I don't care if you're right, wrong, indifferent. You better be going full go. So, second preseason game come around, and I was told I was probably going to get to play in the third. Mm-hmm. Third quarter go by. I'm like, oh, man. Fourth quarter, I'm like, I'm going to play now. Nah. Fourth quarter go halfway through. I'm like, yo, I'm not finna play. They winning. Last 2 minutes of the, there was like 1 minute left in the game. They up, so they finna just run this ball. So I'm like, I'm not finna get no action out of the corner. So I get in with 1 minute left in the game. 1 minute left in the game, and they lined up. It was third and one. And like I said, I don't know nothing about the play, but I'm really just playing ball. But it was one thing I remember. They lined up in a certain formation. They going to run this play. It was a run play, just straight up a gut. Dudes, the running backs were trying to bounce it out to the corner and make a man miss. Mm-hmm. So I'm looking. I'm like, they not going to do this right now. On third one, they not going to run this play. Man, I was like, all right, if this dude blocked down, this running back step forward, I'm gone. I don't care. He blocked down, shot back in the backfield, made a TFL, and turned the ball over. And one of the vets told me, the coordinator looked over at the vet and was all like, he going to safety next week. Next week. All right, check this out. You're going to be a second string safety. You got to learn what to do. I'm like, what? So now I got to, now everything ramped up again. Keep in mind, it's dudes that's been there since OTA, since all that. I wasn't there for none of that. You know what I'm saying? I'm off the street. You know what I mean? So now I got to hurry up and quickly learn strong safety, this and that, and the rotations. And I'm just like, ain't no way. Like, it's just, it was so much information. So I'm literally out there, bro. I'm out there just playing. Like, I'm playing. Like, I don't really have a clue. I'm looking to my veteran safety. I'm like, tell me where to go. I don't know where to go. Like, he was like, I got you. So he would just tell me where to go. And I was just playing ball, man. Second game, played my heart. I had like 7 tackles that game. And the last game I did decent and came down to cut down days. And I was like, man, you know, at this point, I'm just like, if I can just get a practice squad shot, I'll be fine. I just need another shot. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, they called me up. Hey, bring your iPad. I'm like, damn, I got cut again. Like, God, not again. So I go up there, and, you know, Dan Quinn and TD bring me in. They go, man, look, we really like what you put out there. We really like what you did, and we really think we can develop you. So we're going to bring you in on the practice squad. A lot of dudes don't like to hear that. I said, I don't care. I'm the happy. I looked around, I was like, look, you don't know what you just did. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm the happiest man in the world. So ended up going to ATL. Was on practice squad for about like 10 weeks. About week 11, 12, I got activated to the active roster. You know, working hard, working my butt off. Played my first game against my brother's former team in Green Bay, which was dope. Mm-hmm. And, yeah, so we went through that. Next year come around, and they go, okay, we're going to move you back to corner. I'm like, yo, what? Like, and it was a change of coaching staff, too, so, you know, you got all that, all the politics and stuff. Mm-hmm. Drafted a couple corners. I'm like, so you really just, all right, whatever. I'm going to do what I got to do. So went to corner. I mean, I was doing the best I can, and, you know, they ended up letting me go. I was hurt. I love Atlanta. I love Atlanta to this day. I love them. They cool organization, great team, and, you know, I got let go. Went back home again with my fiance, and a day later, Seattle calls. I'm like, hey. I'm like, all right, cool. So Seattle called, want to bring you in. All right, bet. Go and meet Pete Carroll for the first time. He's like, look, what you want to play? He's like, what you like better, safety or corner? I said, honestly, I love safety better, but I'm just trying to just get somewhere where I can learn the technique, learn what I'm supposed to do. You know, I've been here, I've been there, I ain't really had time to learn, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And he said, I respect it. Went that corner, and then I was duking it out for weeks and weeks and weeks, and came down to, like, the last 4 weeks of the season, man, and they gave me that shot. They activated me. Got on special teams, was doing my thing, played the rest of the year out. You know, we ended up losing to Green Bay. I played again, Green Bay. My brother came to that game. It was dope. And, you know, finished the season there, and then they had brought me back on a little exclusive tender or whatever. So, gave me another shot, man. Mm-hmm. So, now I'm here. But at the end of the day, shoot, I'm still out here fighting for it. But yeah, it's been a dog fight since day one. You know what I mean? So, a little bit different journey than a lot of other dudes, but it's one that I fell in love with because it's me. You know what mm-hmm. I'm saying? Like, it means something to me. It's a testimony. And I got to tell people, man, anything you want, man, if you just go and you just go and you just don't quit, man, you going to get it, man. Mm-hmm. It's a long, hard road, man. It's been a hard road, but I'm still here. You know what I'm saying? Sure. So that's just where I'm at with it right now. So I'm back in it, man. Like I said, working hard, training, just ready to go back to work, man. I just can't wait to get back to Seattle, man, get the season rolling. You know, hopefully everything goes smooth with the other sports so we can get this thing off the ground because I'm trying to, you know, trying to play, man. So it's been wild, bro. It's been wild.
Resiliency, man, for sure.
Wild. Yeah, man. It's been wild, man. It's a crazy, wild time, some tears. Yeah, man. But just got to keep pushing, dog. Yeah. You got to keep pushing, man. So that's all I'm doing, man. Just doing my part, man.
For sure. Mm-hmm. Like, man, just that's the life, man, of an undrafted rookie, for sure. Especially sure. with that injury just already set you back on top of it. That's just crazy life. Hearing all that traveling, bro. Yeah, I can't imagine.
Man, it's been different. I done been, dude, since college, I've been on the road for the past 3-4 years. I have not settled down in one spot. But the cool thing is, like, now with my experiences and stuff and, you know, the other undrafted guys that come in, I show them a lot of love because as an undrafted, you don't really get that love. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And I just try to tell them, like, listen, this is a great opportunity. And when you're in this preseason, you're not playing just for this one team. You're playing for all 32, but you just don't know who's watching. Like, right. That's how they do it. Like, it's been some instances with dudes who would have made the roster. Another team snatched them up. Like, nah, I want them. Like, mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? So that's just kind of how it goes. So you just got to learn how to, like I said, play that game and play your heart out every time you get, man. Every opportunity, you got to take advantage, man. And just
that's run all you could do. I mean, you never know. How many stories you didn't hear about? You know, unfortunately, starter got hurt, this back will come in, new start, you know, whatever the case may be. Just ready. Always be ready.
Absolutely,
for sure.
Bro. Be ready. Be ready and be willing and just do your job. That's it.
All the time. All the time. Bouncing back to college real quick.
Yep.
So going into your senior year, mm-hmm. mentally, where were you at?
So mentally, where was I at? I was in killer mode. So let's just back it up. So my junior year, you know what I'm saying? It's supposed to be your pop out. Like, you know what I'm saying? If you ain't really pop, this got to be your pop out. Yeah, like, it's time to start doing stuff. So, my junior year, you know what I'm saying? I was starting safety, whatever. 5 weeks through the season. Wasn't playing as great. A lot of stuff was going on. Ended up losing my spot to a freshman who goes by the name Jeremy Chinn, who's now second round draft pick for the Carolina Panthers. Mm-hmm. But hey, look, I ain't never been a person to hate on nobody. I always look at myself as, what could I have done better? You know what I'm saying? So I showed them, you know, love, taught them up, whatever I had to do. But I was always, you know, I was always for people. So my senior year, I was just like, you know what? I'm not going to let nobody take nothing from me ever again. Like, I'm not going to leave no stone unturned. I got somewhere I need to be. I'm trying to go to the league. You know what I'm saying? Like, I came, and this is why I'm here. So just putting in all that dog work, working hard, and it was just staying focused. Like, man, I'm trying to get to the – that's the only thing I kept saying. I'm trying to get to the league. And, you know, sometimes you gotta take the backlash. I mean, you ain't go – you know what I'm saying? Like, man, nobody come out of SIU like that. Like, and it was the truth. Like, nobody really do come out of SIU like that. The last draft pick we had was my freshman year. His name is Michael Pruitt. He played for the Tennessee Titans right now. But that was the last time somebody got drafted. Chinn was the next – you know what I'm saying, the next one. So I was just like, I'm making it. I don't care. And, you know what I'm saying? So my senior year, I was just like, man, nah, I'm going to get this, man. This is everything. This is it. It's my last shot, dude. It's my last shot. So that was just my whole mentality towards it. And then when I think about it now, like, just because of this whole coronavirus and everything, a lot of the seniors around the country, high school, college, can't play their last season. And it's like, when I look at myself, I'm like, that season meant everything for me. Like, my senior season was everything. And it's like, if it wasn't for that last year, could I say I would have been in the same spot? Absolutely not. Like, and it break my heart when I see that, so I definitely feel for them, man. It's like, dude, that's it. You know what I'm saying? And, you know, thank God I still have the opportunity to finish it out, but, man, I definitely feel for them kids, man, because I'm not the only one that's in this position. You know what I mean? Like, there's a lot of others in this position, too. So But yeah, man, my senior year, it was just, hey, we got to get it by any means. Gotta get it by any means. This is it. You know what I'm saying? Back against the wall. Let's go. So,
yeah,
yeah, bro, that's how I came to it, man.
Speaking now, like in the NFL, well, not just now, but throughout your time in NFL, what, this is like a three-parter. What would you say was your most difficult time? What players have helped you the most throughout your time?
That's a good question.
And I'm assuming you like playing safety, like you said. So who do you try to mold your game after?
Man, that's a great question. I think I'm going to start with the second part first. I got to pay homage to my guys, man. So, okay. Well, we can actually go back to Philly with this. So, Malcolm Jenkins made me realize this game is very detailed. It's a chess match. He is probably, if not the smartest player I've ever been around. Like, a guy who was, you know, up there in age, not as fast, not as strong as he used to be, but since his mind is so sharp, he is still making plays like he's 20-something. You know what I mean? So that was one. ATL, shout out to my guy Brian Poole, man. Undrafted dog, nickel. He got another contract with the Jets. Show me love. Ricardo Allen, my boy DeMonte KZ. Shout out to my dog, man. It's so many others, man. It's so many people. Who else? I'll just say this, having the opportunity to play around Julio was dope. You know what I'm saying? Man, like learning, seeing how a future Hall of Famer approaches the game changed my perspective. He coming to practice and he going 1,000. Like there is no in between. So definitely another one that kind of gave me that knowledge, man. My dog Keanu Neal, man, shout out to him. He was the reason why I learned most of the safety stuff. It's, when he was hurt that year, he would literally make me stand next to him on game day and he would tell me, he's like, I want you to get the call, and I want you to make the adjustment. I want you to tell me what's like, what's going on. So I was standing next to him, like, all right, they're doing this, is that. Like, that's how I learned the game. So shout out to him. Let me see, Seattle. Man, Seattle just been great, man. Seattle was cool. Getting an opportunity to play Bobby Wagner, of course, Russell Wilson, of course. Just seeing what a winning culture looks like. It's that, I can just kind of dedicate that to Seattle. Like, seeing what winning is. Like, how do you win in this league? They definitely taught me that. So, that's that, man. A lot, like I said, I know I miss some names, but it's a lot of dudes. My brother, I can't miss that. My brother, for sure. First and foremost, my brother, yeah. First and foremost, taught me the game before I got there. You know what I'm saying? So I kind of know the lay of the land, know a lot of people through him, and got to talk to a lot of guys like Tremont Williams. Like, got to get some advice and tips from him, and just, you know, I can't leave him out that conversation. So definitely him. And then let me see. That's I know. Like I said, I'm missing others, but man, shout out to everybody that helped me along the way. Cause I never forget people that helped me along the way. That's so much love. Coaches alike too. Like I said, C-Jack, M, my coaches now, even past, man. Shout out to my college coach Marty Rogers, man. Definitely another one that kind of helped me along the way. So yeah, it's been a lot of dudes. And then let me see. It's a 3-part question. What was the first part again?
What would you say the most difficult thing about the NFL is?
Ooh, most difficult. I think the most difficult is that you have to understand that this is first and foremost a business. You know what I'm saying? Like, before anything, get your emotions out. It is a business. When you, like I said, undrafted call, when I got undrafted to Philly, you don't play for Philly. You are literally trying out for Philly. Like, that's what you got to think. I'm trying out for the rest of the league, understanding that the hard decisions will be made. I've seen people get cut left and right all the time. When you're on the practice squad, that's another testament too. Being on the practice squad is a rough life because it's basically you, in essence, a scout team player. But, like, every week, the practice squad is the only squad that can have people cut and let go like this at any time. So literally, my first year in Atlanta, it was about 4 of us that you can only have like 10. Literally, 3 of us was there the whole year. Everybody else was cut left and right. You know what I'm saying? Like, so you talk about being nervous, man. Look, when you see them working out DBs, you're like, oh no, nah, what's going? Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, you know what I mean? So that pressure, that's it, right? The pressure of the business is like it's unreal. Like, seeing that they are immediately, when they get you, they looking for somebody better than you right now. Like, that's what it is, and you have to remember that. So it's like, when you go to practice, there is no slough practice. It's like when you go to high school, and I ain't doing that. Oh, you go to college, yeah, feeling, yeah. There is none of that. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, the scouts are on the side. They're writing notes. They literally great. Like, after every practice, you're getting talked about. They meet about you every day. I seen it. Like, I literally seen. Like, literally, you see what everybody writing about you. What the weight room coach think about you. What the training staff think about you. What the coaches think about you. What do the cafeteria women and men think about you. Like, everybody is writing about you. So it was like, that constant pressure of being in that position is a whole, it'll wear you out, man. So it's like, God, like, but you just got to remember, you got to bring your best every day, literally all the time. So that's probably the biggest struggle of it all, for real, man. And like I said, I mean, you know, like I just explained in my story, you know, having to go from place to place and learn new systems and try to get my butt off that practice squad and get activated. I did it twice. So it's like, it's a testament. It's just like, you got to fight, dude. It's a fight every day for sure. So that is definitely the struggle of it all, just the business aspect of it.
Man, the pressure is crazy.
It's real. I'm telling, like, literally, you see a new face, and it's like, who he coming to get? Like, and, right. and they call him Grim Reapers. You know who come down to come grab players to tell them, like, hey, yo, somebody, Coach Carroll or so-and-so want to see you. Like, you know who that person is. When you see him come down the stairs, you're like, oh, damn, like, let me get out the way. He better not be coming for me if I don't, man. Like, and it was funny because, I make jokes all the time. Oh, don't bring your butt around here. They'd be like, laughing. I ain't coming. Like, I know you ain't coming to get me. Keep moving. But, yeah, but it's real, man. Like I said, a lot of people in the real world, it's like, it's something that a lot of people don't really see in, like, a regular job.
No,
like,
you know what I'm saying?
Sure, you can go off your Facebook. You can complain about your job. You now can go out. All right. Complain about your job. They're going to have somebody there tomorrow for you. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So, that's real, man. And then the last part. What was the last part there?
Who do you try to mold your game after? At safety.
That's a good question, man. I look up to a lot of the greats, man. I think just mold after. I wouldn't necessarily say mold after. Because you know what? I come to realize, like, when you try to, I don't even want to say that, but more times other than not, when you try to emulate somebody's game, you lose part of yours. And it's like, what I'm trying to do now is understand and look at myself and say, what am I great at? What am I good at? What are my weak points? And where can I get better? You know what I'm saying? So, but what I do look up to is guys who are smart, like Ricardo Allen, a very smart, very, very smart safety. Like, just realizing what made guys like go, like Charles Woodson, one of the smartest DBs, like, and it not only athletic and talent alone, but it was just, he was smart. You know what I'm saying? So understanding that, if you want to mold your game, you need to really learn the game, like understand the game to, like, it's a chess match. You know what I'm saying? So now, instead of me having to rely on my talent and taking extra steps and doing this alone, I know where I need to be and when I need to be there, so I can do it just like that, no matter what. You know what I mean? So, but I look up to a lot of safeties, man. I love a lot of safeties in the league now. And, you know, my boy K's ball hawking, man. Look at my boy Quandre Diggs, you know, B-Mac. Excellent players, man. Jamal Adams is a hell of a player. I love his energy. He's a monster. I love him. Bo Jack from Chicago is a ball hog, man. You know, even to the old heads like Charles Woodson and Ed Reed and Troy. Like, they all, you look at the game, man. Troy Polamalu is just, it's fat. Like, he was just 100% everywhere. Like, he never ran slow. It's just like, God, you look at the film, you just, I'm like, man. So, it's a lot of the greats, man. I just, like, shoot, Earl Thomas in the back end, showing you how to be a middle of the field safety, how to go get that ball, and how to tackle open field. It, like I said, I can go down the list forever. I pay homage, man. I love them all, man. I love everything about everyone's game. So, just trying to figure out, how can I make that into one? You know what I'm saying? Like, and like I said, use my style of play. You know what I'm saying? How can I make Ryan Neal's style of play pop off the tape? You know what I mean? So, that's kind of how I move on with that. You know what I mean? So,
it's really been a blessing, man, because all these players that you're naming are all impact guys. Like, for sure. You've been around a lot of good defensive backs.
Man, a lot of good ones, man. Like, and I appreciate it, because you get to, this is where you learn where you have to get to. You know what I'm saying? And you can't let, like, and this goes in life too. If you're the best one or the smartest one in your circle, you need to move to another circle. So I appreciated the pressure of being around Malcolm Jenkins. Like, you need to know this stuff. Like, when Coach would, like he'll ask us, like, what play would they run on 31 in this formation? And literally, we wouldn't know. Malcolm, come on, bro. Like, you, like, just like, why? Man, he would draw the whole thing up. Like, this is what they're going to run. They would run that. You know what I'm saying? So just having that pressure of understanding, you know, guys been in this game 10 years. You know what I'm saying? Like, 10 years in the league.
Yeah.
You got to soak that up, man. You got to love it. It's like, man, I appreciate that. You know what I'm saying? Soaking up game from who and Matt Ryan. Just like, man, just good. Like, you know what I'm saying? Just being able to be around that. So, it's been a blessing for real, man. Like you said, I've been around a lot of great dudes. Bobby Wagner, KJ Wright, Russell Wilson. When Marshawn came back, that was the coolest thing in the world. Oh, my God. He's probably one of my favorite people to be around. I love that dude. He is awesome, but... Yeah, man, having that opportunity to be around them, dude, it's been dope for sure. I love it, man. So that's what's cool about it.
I think the biggest thing I'm learning from you saying this about sports, like, I consider myself a great sports mind, but I always underestimated the value of vets. Man. Because people only see on the field. Mm-hmm. Like, they don't see all of this teaching, all of this knowledge that they're giving to the younger.
Yeah, man. Like, I'm telling you, dude, the game is much deeper than, he fast and he can run, he big, he can dunk, he can jump. Nah. If you rely on that alone, you're not going to make it very far. Right. Like, that's just the way it is. And, you know, I tell people all the time when, you know, fans watch a football game, it's like they just seeing people running the ball and hitting. I'm like, you don't even see the beauty of the game. Mm-hmm. Like, even with basketball, like, I'm still learning, like, dang, that's how they do it. Like literally, like, man, this is so, like, really cool. Like, that's how they do it. And you just got to understand the game is deep. It runs deep. Man. Like, in life, man, everything is just one. You got to know the lay of the land. Like we said earlier with the whole racial injustice thing, you got to know the game. Know the politics of the game. You got to learn the game. You want to win the game, learn the game. You know, screaming and shouting get you so far. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And I love it. I love people getting out there and they speaking and they talking, but it's like, okay, where do you go from here? You know what I'm saying? So I definitely love that about the game, man. You got to know, you know, the vet, the value of the vet, which is why you see, like, these 70 vets always around. They still here. They still getting contracts. Like, they have that experience, that wisdom and knowledge that these young dudes, you know, and this is myself, we don't have that. You know what I'm saying? You got to have that presence. So, heck yeah, man. Always appreciate the old heads, man.
Yeah, man, for sure. So, what's your expectations, man? Of course, Lombardi Trophy, always expectations, for but sure. Personal goals that you have for this season?
Man, first and foremost, like I said, I've been, you know, a journeyman these past couple years. I want to make the roster right out the gate. That's my first goal, immediate goal, make the roster right out the gate. Get on that 53, don't get nobody a chance, you know what I'm saying? You go for it, and now that I've been through the ringer twice and I see how to do it, I know how to do it. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, okay, definitely take advantage of that. Lombardi always, man. Definitely staying healthy, want to be injury free. I want to be able to play every snap that I can, when I can. You know, making plays, man. Shoot, give me a pick. I need a pick, man. I need a pick, dude. You know what I'm saying? But
sure.
Definitely, you know, and eventually one day for sure become a starter. But I already know I got to work my way. So I'm more than willing to do that. And so, like I said, man, first and foremost, make that 53 Lombardi for sure and stay healthy. You know what I'm saying? So that's definitely what's up with it.
Good chance, man. Seattle is nice.
Oh, I love it, man. It's a great organization. It's like probably, you know, second to none, to be honest.
No, definitely top of the class for sure.
For sure.
I mean, you got basically Hall of Famers on each side of the ball and the two most important positions.
Yeah, bro.
You always got a chance.
Yeah, man. Great leadership over there, dude. Wonderful leadership.
So I want to leave with this question right here. One, what do you plan to do after the football career?
Mm-hmm.
And two, just any advice you would have for a high school, college athlete?
I'll start with the second part first. So any advice, man, you know, high school, college, you know, have fun with it. High school is probably the most fun fashion of football. You know what I'm saying? There's no business. There's no incentive. So you're really just out there having fun. So understand that first and foremost. Have fun with it. You know what I'm saying? Taking those Friday night light moments, because we all miss it. You can ask any of the players, and then they'll tell you to this day, like, I miss them Friday night lights, so that's something for sure. Have fun with it and just take care of your business, man. You know what I mean? I know people don't want to hear it, man, do your work. You know what I'm saying? Do the right thing. And really, it's do the right thing to make it easier for yourself. You know what I'm saying? Don't make it harder for yourself. And for high school and college athletes, especially ones that's trying to get to that league, don't let character be a knock on you. Like, you don't want no scout to say, oh, well, these coaches say you kind of got a bad edge. Like, you don't, that's like the last thing somebody should say about you. Like, wherever you go, you show love, you show respect, you know what I'm saying? And you just keep your nose clean, you know what I mean? Don't be out there, you know, just doing dumb stuff to do dumb stuff. Have fun, I get it. It's college and high school, have fun. But understand, take care of your business so you can make it easy on yourself, so you can go out and have fun, so you can party, and you don't got to worry about people harping on you and all that other stuff. Just take care of your business and stick with the process for sure, man. And shoot, now more than ever, you starting to see these young boys. Now they getting trained. I ain't never seen nothing like this before. Just these young kids training and all that. But, you know, have fun with it. Don't let it – don't come out the gate saying, like, I'm going to be – you know what I'm saying? Like, have fun. You know what I mean? Play a lot of sports. Get well-rounded. You get skills from other sports. You know what I'm saying? Don't just be specialized in one. Go ahead and play baseball. I regret not playing a different sport when I was in high school. I wish I would have hooped a little more. I wish I would have played baseball. Like, do that, man. It's fun. And, you know, when you end up getting to the stage, man, like I said, do the right thing. Treat people how you want to be treated, man. And don't let your character be a knock on you. That's the last thing. Like, everywhere you go, people should say something good about you. Like, when another team call for you, man, they say a lot of good things about you. That's what you want to hear. Like, you know, I appreciate that. It's genuine love. So That's probably the best advice I can give you. And then as far as what I want to do, man, shoot, I got to start thinking about this. For real. I mean, I ain't really thought about it because I'm just, you know, I'm so wrapped up in trying to just get good at this. You know what I'm saying? I'm trying to, you know, commit to it and sell my soul to it, essentially. But I honestly don't know, man. I mean, I had a lot of people ask me, you have to think about coaching. I'm like, I don't know. I know I could be good at it. You know what I'm saying? I know it's something I will be good at, but if it was anything, I'd probably jump into that, man. Coaching, you know, my brother, he's out there doing real estate. He's been teaching me game on real estate this whole time. So it's like, it's definitely another avenue I can jump into if I want to. So, you know, just doing that. And then, like I'm doing now, just keep on spreading the message, spreading the word, uplifting, being positive, giving back to the 219 and the community, and just keeping it pushing from there, man. Have a family one day, you know, all that good stuff, man. Mm-hmm. So that's just kind of where I'm at with it, man. So, yeah.
I could definitely see you being a coach for sure. Just because of that, the energy that you
bring. Man, I know. God. Man, the thing is, man, being a football player is already time consuming. Being a coach.
Yeah.
Man, they put the time in, but you know what? They love it. You know what I'm saying? They love it. And I love it too. You know what I mean? I love the game. I love it to its core. It's not just about running the hit. It's about the X's and O's and the details and the history and all that. So I would definitely be interested in coaching it. But, you know, you never know. You might see me coaching somewhere. You never know. So we don't make it happen, man. But, yeah, that's kind of where I'm at with it, man. 2020.
You never know, man.
For sure, dude.
So we're going to wrap it up here, man. Definitely big shout out to Ryan for coming through. A lot of good messages, man, for sure.
Shout out to y'all for bringing me in, man. My boy, man. Hey, stayed across the street from me, man. I'm telling you, we go way back. But, man, appreciate you bringing me on here. Like I said, this is something I love to do. Giving back to the 219 and just uplifting each other. Why not? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
everybody
sure.
Got something going on up here. There's so much up here. Mm-hmm. And to all y'all out there listening, man, like I said, there's a lot out here. We can do a lot more if we just help each other. You know what I mean? Like me using what I got. Jumping around, helping other people out, and like, hey, let's get on board. Let's make this a great place. You know what I'm saying? Let's make this a place where you would want to be. Because, like, it's family. You know what I mean? We all know each other. We know what's up. So let's just put each other on. You know what I'm saying?
Say it all the time, man. It's a lot of talent up here, man.
Man, absolutely. A lot of talent that get overlooked. I tell a lot of people that all the time, like, when they talk about football, I'm like, there's so much talent that just got looked over. And it's like, man, that's why I'm glad. Like, man, shout out to my boys, John Bay and Lonnie Johnson, man. Just coming out of Gary with it. Mm-hmm. Still remember to this day, man. We did a freaking radio interview when we were all in high school. It was me, Lonnie, John Bay, Jalen was there. David Yancey was there. And it was just like, man, and this is when we was talking about going to school. And now you look up and, you know what I'm saying, me, Lonnie, John Bay, we still in. We still fighting. And it's good for the area. You get to see more and more of us sprouting out. And, you know, it's time to expose that. It's time to expose that talent that's hidden up here. It's too much. You know what I'm saying? It's
way too much.
And that's not even just sports. I'm talking business.
Everything.
Man, I'm talking people. We done went to high school with brand managers and Forex. And I'm just like, man, there's so many great things coming out of here that we got to just start hooking each other up. It's like, man, let's just start hooking this stuff up, man. Mm-hmm. So, man, shout out to the 219 for sure, man.
Show, man.
For sure.
Fresh Squeeze, episode 20.
A nigga like me, I get in that gym, I get out so smooth. A nigga like you, you get in that gym, don't know what to do. Don't know what to do, don't know what to do, don't know what to do. Don't know what to do, don't know what to do, don't know what to do.